The Caribbean is famous all over the world for its beautiful coastline and friendly communities. The small fishing villages and their colorful boats seem like a perfect image of a simple and peaceful life. But the reality for many Caribbean fishermen is that life is getting much harder. The cost of living is going up, and the fishing is not as good as it used to be. The reefs are no longer home to as many fish, and the once huge snappers and groupers are seldom caught anymore. As each year goes by, the fish are harder to find. Fishermen have to work longer hours and go further and deeper in search of their catch. Overfishing has left many reefs barren and covered in algae, as the grazing parrotfish are too few to keep the corals clean. In recent years, the health of Caribbean reefs has been made worse by mass coral bleaching events caused by unusually warm seas, the result of global warming. Bleached corals can recover, but are less likely to do so on overfished reefs, where they rapidly get overgrown with algae. The arrival of the lionfish is yet another threat to the livelihoods of fishermen. This invasive species, introduced by mistake to the Caribbean a few years ago, has few predators and is rapidly spreading across the region, feeding voraciously on small reef fish. The reefs around Jamaica have been particularly badly affected, and according to scientists, overfishing is so bad that most reef fish are caught before they are 1 year old. This leaves very few fish behind to grow big enough to breed and replenish the stocks. Kevin, a fisherman from Bluefields on the southwest coast of Jamaica, has learned to clean and cook lionfish, which tastes surprisingly good. Like other fishermen in Bluefields, he remembers the days when fish were plentiful and fuel was cheap.
When you go fishing, if you catch 300 pounds, 200 pounds of fish, it's only maybe about 10 to 15 pounds. Cover the expense. Now, it takes about 60 to 70 pounds to cover your expense, but you don't catch that much fish anymore. So you maybe catch 100 pounds at 150 pounds. You understand? So fishing now is all about, we in Jamaica, we call it hand to mouth. Yeah? It's a kind of hand to mouth situation now.
Many fishermen in Jamaica can't afford a boat and only use a spear gun. One of the most skillful is Wong, a fisherman from Boscobel on the north coast. To make ends meet, Wong has to go fishing twice a day. Each time, he must swim out beyond the reef to the fishing grounds. Despite his great fitness and accuracy with his spear, he often has no choice but to catch small fish to provide income and food for his children and wife.
Fishing is, what I call it then, the bread basket for most people in Jamaica that live along the shoreside. And right now I hear they're talking about they want to cut out spear shooting, but they don't have to cut it out everywhere. Just like we have the sanctuary here that don't allow spear shooting, the other places that they don't have sanctuary, they can't allow them to shoot, because cutting out spear fishing right now, a lot of family don't have nothing else to depend on, because there's no work here. You can't see that. There's no work here.
The collapse in fisheries has been an economic and social tragedy for many of Jamaica's coastal villages, whose livelihoods revolved around fishing. Fishing boats built with hard-earned savings lie idle, and once thriving communities are now threatened by increasing unemployment, poverty, and crime. The challenges facing Jamaican fishermen are daunting, but a new initiative supported by Wong, Kevin, and many others is bringing new hope that one day the fish will come back. Fishing communities around the island have come together with the government and scientists to create a network of fish sanctuaries in order to try and restore the once bountiful fisheries. In 2010, 8 new fish sanctuaries were passed into law, and more are being planned. The largest of these sanctuaries is at Bluefields Bay, where 10 kilometers of coastline have been closed off to all types of fishing. The Bluefields Bay Fishermen Friendly Society has signed an agreement with the government and is now responsible for managing the sanctuary. Their chairman, Walde Christos, is spearheading the community's efforts to enforce the regulations.
Now, the persons who are patrolling the bay are actually, who are wardens, are fishermen. And so the fishers are very, very integral in its protection. Right now, we're getting, during daylight, we're getting up to 85% compliance, where persons are staying out of the fish sanctuary. We have a few that we're working with, and we know that with 24-hour patrol, when we do get funding for that, we're going to see, I would say, at least 99%.
Further east, the Caribbean Coastal Area Management Foundation, who represents over 7,000 fishermen in the Portland Bight, have been given a mandate to manage four new fish sanctuaries, which have been created in areas of mangroves and seagrass.
The fish sanctuaries were determined in consultation with the fishers, but like everything else, not everybody agrees. And I think in the short term, some persons might see that it's going to impact negatively on their livelihood. But what we're saying is that that might happen in the short term, but the long-term gains will be far greater than not having the sanctuaries, because the area is overfished, they're catching less fish, and sometimes no fish at all.
The new network of sanctuaries could not have been created without the support of government, and in particular, the Fisheries Division.
Sanctuaries are important from our perspective because it does a couple of things. Firstly, it is a tangible approach towards trying to promote sustainable fisheries. Along with the sanctuaries has to come public education. And so all of us, spearheaded by government, but including several agencies, are now embarking on a program to help to inform, to educate, and to change behavioral patterns amongst the artisanal fishers on the beaches themselves by trying to get them to appreciate the value of the sanctuaries in terms of expanding the fish population.
Dr. Carl Aiken, an expert in fisheries from the University of the West Indies, has been a key figure since the start.
And that is the principle of all marine protected areas, where unfished stock of fish or conch or lobsters reproduces, reaches a big size, reproduces, and then the young flow outwards into the adjoining areas, which can then, after a period of time of protection, be fished. And in this way, we have a slow replenishment of a stock of animals that has been really hammered for a very long time, perhaps as much as 100 years. People don't realize how intense fishing has been around Jamaica.
When a fish sanctuary is created, the fishermen and government agree on the location of a boundary that defines the area where fishing is no longer allowed. What happens to the fish? First of all, the fish inside the sanctuary get bigger and more abundant. After a year or two, the sanctuary has substantially more and bigger fish than the area outside. Some fish start moving out of the sanctuary into areas where fishermen can legally catch them. This is called the spillover effect and can increase their catch significantly. The real benefit, though, is that the large fish inside the sanctuary breed and produce eggs. And these eggs drift outside the sanctuary. In time, the sanctuary becomes an important source of fish and eggs for the surrounding area, which is why some people call them replenishment reserves. What people often don't realize is how important big fish are to the sustainability of fisheries and how dramatically egg production increases as fish get bigger. A snapper that is 30 centimeters long will produce around 360,000 eggs. From that number of eggs, one might expect about three fish to survive to maturity. A fish that is 45 centimeters long will produce around four times as many eggs, or around 1.3 million, equivalent to about 13 adult fish. And a fish that is 60 centimeters long will produce around 10 times as many eggs, or around 3.4 million eggs, equivalent to about 34 adult fish. Clearly, allowing some fish to grow big makes a lot of sense. One of the most successful marine parks that has been shown to increase fish stocks in the surrounding area is the Soufriere Marine Management Area on the west coast of St. Lucia, underneath the famous pitons. When it was established in 1992, the park had two main objectives. to rebuild the stocks of fish that had been depleted and to manage the busy coastal area around the pitons, where fishermen, tour operators, divers, and visiting yachts were competing for space. The fishermen and the local stakeholders were all actively involved in planning the marine park. When the fishing stopped inside the marine reserves in 1995, marine biologists monitored the fish populations for several years and noticed something quite dramatic. The total weight of fish inside the reserves doubled in the first year, and then, despite a setback caused by Hurricane Lenny in 1999, doubled again over the following years to produce a four-fold increase in the total weight of fish. But what was perhaps even more surprising was that in the areas outside the reserves, the amount of fish also increased dramatically, with a threefold increase over the six-year period.
Some fishers have actually indicated that they've seen bigger fish. I have actually personally seen larger parrot fish, the grazers that are important to reef health. I have seen them 10 years ago. You could probably barely see a parrot fish about the size of the palm. And now over in Jalousie, in just a small marine protected area there, you can see almost a foot or you know, perhaps 16 inches long parrot fish.
The park's only source of revenue comes from entrance fees paid by divers and a mooring fee paid by visiting yachts. It is no longer enough to support the increasing demands being placed on the park manager and his staff.
We are one of the marine parks, one of the only ones in the Caribbean that, well, depend almost exclusively, or rather exclusively, on user fees for all of our cost, our salaries, maintenance of infrastructure, everything is actually paid for from our user fees. Currently, we are at a point where we're not collecting enough revenue to actually sustain all of our activities.
In the past year, the lack of funding has affected the rangers' ability to enforce the park's regulations, and some of the older fishermen who support the reserve are frustrated that the marine reserve is not always respected.
Fishermen all over the world right now, please, I am begging you, protect the little that we have for the future generation. Do not destroy it and say we're going after the money. The money is, yes, it's good for us to have, but what does it profit us to destroy our generation? Because our generation ain't gonna have nothing to see, nothing in the future. You might be able to say, oh, this is a sardine, but what is a sardine? They don't even know, because we destroyed the sardine. Let us try and protect the little that we have.
At the other end of the Caribbean, in Belize, is another of the region's most successful marine protected areas, the Halchan Marine Reserve. Halchan has been protected since 1987 and is now a spectacular site where shoals of fish grow and breed in safety. The enormous snappers and groupers are a clear sign that protection is effective, and are also a huge attraction for tourists who come from all over the world to snorkel and dive. The money spent by visitors in hotels, restaurants, and on crafts and souvenirs supports hundreds of small businesses and livelihoods in the neighboring community of San Pedro. But the park would not be a success without the participation and support of the fishermen. And they like the park because they catch more fish in the surrounding areas.
People from the nearby communities, such as San Pedro, Key Carker, Belize City, make a living by taking customers there. That is definitely a measurement of success. The traditional fishermen were allowed to continue their practices, with the exception of the coral reef. All the other zones, yes, they can fish. They have increased their catch.
The success of Halchan and the benefits it generates for fisheries, tourism, and the environment has encouraged other fishing communities in Belize to establish their own fish sanctuary. One of these is on the neighboring island of Key Corker.
We sell it to them as a bank. When we do our education programs, we tell them it's like having a bank. This conservation zone is an area where you deposit the fish. You leave them there, they will grow. That will be your interest. We cannot cage them. And they understand that they will have to leave that area. So that is how they have come aware that a marine reserve is a management tool, is a fishery tool for them to ensure that there will be for the future.
The involvement of the community in the planning and management of marine parks is now recognized by most governments in the Caribbean as critical to their success. But this was not always the case, and most of the region's older marine parks were established with very little consultation with fishermen. One of these older parks is the Folkestone Marine Reserve on the west coast of Barbados.
The Marine Reserve was established in 1981, and in the lead-up to the establishment of the Marine Reserve, there was not a lot of consultation with the fishermen in the area, the community stakeholders of the area. And so you found that there was not a lot of cooperation. As the years have passed, what has happened is that the new generations have looked at other avenues of revenue generation.
With over 1 million visitors per year, the inshore waters on Barbados's west coast are a busy place, with water sports, glass bottom boats, and large catamarans. The park manager and his staff have been busy managing and zoning the activities of tourists, and with the installation of markers and moorings, they have successfully reduced anchor damage and collisions. But below the surface, their success has been limited. The fish population inside the reserve has not increased. The fish are small and they are virtually no conch or lobster. Perhaps if the fishermen had been involved in the planning and management of the park and had been made aware of the benefits it could bring to their livelihoods, they would have been more willing to respect the regulations, and perhaps the Folkestone Marine Reserve today would look a bit more like Halchan. In Jamaica, the situation is very different, and the new sanctuaries are being established on a foundation of strong community support. It is the fishermen and their communities who are leading the effort to manage the sanctuaries. The patrols are often done by fishermen who understand that by protecting the fish, they are protecting their livelihoods. The support of government and the fisheries division has been critical, providing resources and laws that ensure that the boundaries and regulations are officially recognized and that the Coast Guard and police are ready to assist with enforcement when required. Effective park management, even with strong local support, is expensive. It requires constant enforcement, public education, and monitoring. The big challenge facing Jamaica's fish sanctuaries is financial support. Some large companies, such as Sandals Resorts International and Island Outpost, have started getting involved and now actively support the sanctuaries. With the support of fishermen and the government, they are even planning to establish new sanctuaries.
The fishermen have been engaged from the beginning. We do have a mesh exchange program that's going to occur, and they were actively involved in the exact dimensions of the proposed sanctuary. Once the sanctuary is put in, it will be gazetted and will eventually become a protected area, an official protected area.
To strengthen this growing momentum of support, a new initiative is being funded by UKAID from the Department for International Development that will provide financial and technical assistance to 15 fish sanctuaries across the Caribbean. This large initiative, called the Caribbean Fish Sanctuary Partnership, or CFISH, is being implemented by the CaribSave Partnership through the Caribbean Community Climate Change Center. CFISH is providing sanctuary managers with patrol boats, additional wardens, and equipment required for effective enforcement. It is also providing support and training for monitoring, an essential component of park management. New methods to monitor fish stocks inside the sanctuaries have been developed with local communities and scientists to allow the fish stocks to be assessed. The economic and social benefits generated by the fish sanctuaries will also be evaluated in the surrounding communities by social scientists and community assessors. To encourage the long-term financial sustainability of the sanctuaries, a new fund called the Sea Fish Fund is being developed by CaribSave together with Sandals, Virgin Holidays, the Travel Foundation, Island Outpost, and other large companies. This fund will encourage tourists to contribute by buying locally made crafts that have a small donation factored into the price.
Our needs are partnerships. Partnerships in terms of driving the development. If we look at environmental protection, we would like to have a fund, a dedicated fund.
The future for Jamaican fishermen does not have to be one of poverty and declining fish stocks. We know that fish sanctuaries can help to restore fisheries and the productivity of reefs. By sharing the experiences of fishermen across the Caribbean and by learning from their successes and failures, the Jamaican fish sanctuaries have a better chance of being successful. It will require strong and determined leadership and the active support of government, scientists, businesses, and the public. And most importantly, success will depend on the willingness of communities to come together and work together to build a brighter future for themselves and for their children.